More than 5.5 million people have attended one of Greg Laurie's Harvest Crusades. And if these massive festivals with packed out crowds conjure up images of Woodstock, well, that's not a bad thing. Greg says that era kicked off the Jesus Revolution, and it can be a model for reaching the youth of today.
Greg Laurie, pastor of one of the largest churches in America, gave his life to the Lord during the beginning of the Jesus movement in the early 70s.
In the past 40 years, this life that I've been living has led me to share my experiences with literally millions of people looking for truth.
In his new book, Jesus Revolution, Greg Laurie, along with Ellen Vaughn, shares remarkable true stories of the Jesus movement. He draws on important parallels with our time of spiritual apathy and downright hostility, offering hope for the next great American revival.
Well, Greg Laurie joins us now for more, and we welcome you to the program today.
Thank you, Terry. Great to be here.
You come with such a fascinating subject for me, the Jesus Revolution. I love the Volkswagen bus. All painted up on the front.
We're going to make that in real life. That's a design that we did
in
Photoshop, but we're actually creating one in real life as well for fun.
Makes a statement.
Yeah.
You and I both came to the Lord in the Jesus movement, as it was called at that time in 1970s, 60s, 70s. That was a very turbulent time in our country. Where were you at before you came to Christ?
Well, I was without God. I mean, my mother was a beautiful woman, literally a Marilyn Monroe lookalike. Mm. She was married and divorced 7 times. She was a raging alcoholic. I had to grow up quickly and sort of almost be a parent to my own mom because she was that lost. And so at the ripe old age of 17, I was asking the big questions of life, like, what is the meaning of my life? Why am I here? I looked at my mother's world, and I knew the answer was not in the adult world as I knew it. And then I got into drugs, along with a lot of other kids, in the late 60s. And of course, those drugs did not solve our problems. They created new problems. So I was disillusioned with that as well. So for me, it was like a process of elimination, seeing where the truth wasn't. And then on my high school campus, there was a little Bible study of Christians meeting together on the front lawn, singing songs about God. And so I joined them sort of far enough away where I wouldn't be thought of as one of them, but close enough to eavesdrop in the conversation. That was the first time I heard the gospel in a way I understood.
Where was the church at that point? What was happening in the church?
I think the church was, by and large, disconnected and missing the boat. The church was answering questions no one was asking, and they weren't answering the questions that were being asked. When John Lennon was famously quoted to say, the Beatles are more popular than Jesus, there was some truth to that for many kids. And so I think the church sort of caught up. Because the church was not really connecting to this generation. We don't want those kids in here. We don't want the long hair in here. You can't come in here barefoot. And that was a time when the church should have flung the doors wide open, because here's literally a generation. What are they searching for? Peace, love,
They're
joy.
Hungry.
What does the gospel offer? Those things and much more. And I think for the churches, Terry, that opened their doors to the Jesus movement, they experienced revival. And for the churches that did not, they missed it.
Yeah. What started that revival then? I mean, my experience with Christ, though I was nurtured in the church after, did not come from the church. How did it start?
It's a great question. I don't know if I can answer it exactly. It's sort of like little fire started here and there. But, you know, one person said, if you can explain it, God didn't do it. So I don't know if you can exactly explain how and where it started, but everyone knows it started.
Yeah.
In my experience in California, 2 people came together, a guy named Chuck Smith, who was a middle-aged pastor of a relatively small church, and a young hippie guy who became a Christian, who was named Lonnie Frisbee. When they came together, it was like nitro met glycerin, and it sort of exploded. And so that was the initial phase of the Jesus movement as I saw it, but it happened on the East Coast, it happened in Texas, it happened in Europe, in places. So it was very interesting where it popped up, but it was just a spontaneous outpouring of the Holy Spirit around the world, but especially in America.
You know, I've tried to explain it to my kids that I was singing professionally at the time, and so spent some time in Los Angeles, and you could drive down the freeway and somebody would honk their horn born and go like this.
Yes, it's true.
And everybody knew it meant one way to salvation
right.
through Christ. It was bizarre.
Yes.
It was just the culture that we were involved in was permeated
yeah.
with kids who were ecstatic about finding yeah. the truth. What's the similarity? Do you see some between yeah. where young people were at then and where they're at now?
Yeah, I really do. I think the country was unraveling at that point. The year
Vietnam, for one thing, was...
Well, yeah. 1968 was the big year.
Yeah.
You have Martin Luther King assassinated. You have Robert F. Kennedy assassinated. And he had won he would have been probably the president. He had won the primary mm-hmm. for the Democrats, and he was killed in Los Angeles, California. Young men coming home from Vietnam in body bags. Riots in the streets. Huge racial division. It looked like the country was falling apart. Add to this the drug epidemic, the sexual revolution.
Yeah.
So it's all coming together at one time. It's looking so dark. It can almost be summed up by two Time magazine covers. One in the late 60s, ominous black cover, reversed out red letters, "Is God dead?" Question mark. About 3 to 4 years later, a psychedelic image of Jesus on the cover, "Jesus Revolution." What a difference a revival makes. You know, the reason I wrote this book, Terry, Jesus Revolution, is because it's been said that the fame of revival spreads the flame of revival. So I thought, I want to tell the story, but in a way people understand. And I wrote it with Ellen Vaughn, who's an outstanding writer, and she really helped me make this a very thorough book, a little bit of a history lesson, but it takes you there as well. I love that picture of Ellen on the screen right now. So, but it comes down to this. I wrote it to a young person. I didn't write it to someone my age, though many my age will read it, and older even. But I wrote it as though I were sitting across a cup of coffee at a table with a millennial, saying to them, look, this happened to my generation. I pray it happens for you as well. Here's what took place. And because I think there are takeaway truths from then and now. I'm sorry, you asked a question, similarities. It was the country coming apart at the seams.
Yeah.
But I feel like this generation... the millennials are looking for authenticity. They're looking for community. They're not attracted to slick production.
Yeah.
They're not attracted to the mega church model. They want something that's real. And I think we have what they're looking for in a relationship with Christ.
Is the church ready for a movement like that?
Some are, and some maybe are not. You know, I think it depends. You know, for the churches that opened the doors to the Jesus movement, they experienced it. But some churches did not open their doors.
Yeah.
They said no to those kids. So I think we have to be asking ourselves the question first, am I ready for revival?
Yes.
You know, I once asked Pastor Chuck Smith if he thought we would ever see another Jesus revolution movement. And he said, I don't know if we're desperate enough. I think if God's people get desperate enough to pray and follow the template of 2 Chronicles 7:14, which says, God speaking, if my people which are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. Are we desperate enough to pray? Maybe another way to ask it is, do I want revival in my own life? Revival is just returning to original condition, a close relationship with Christ.
Yeah. It's a powerful message. It's a word for today. And we applaud your leadership even bringing us to the place of considering all of this. I want you to know Greg's book with Ellen Vaughn is called Jesus Revolution. It's got the great bus on the front. It's available wherever books are sold. You can pick up a copy in stores nationwide. It's a wonderful message. I'd love to see it. Do it again, God. Do it again.
Amen.
Great to have
you
here.
Thank you.